I thank you, the organization organizers, for giving me the opportunity to be here and to share my views on an extremely interesting and current topic, which is transforming financial dispute resolution landscape, embracing digital solutions. Today, whenever we read the newspapers, we hear about the courts getting choked with pending arrears. I still remember those days in the Supreme Court when piles and piles of files would be delivered to the residents even at 11 o'clock or at 11:30, and the matters would be taken up for hearing the next day. It's not just the Supreme Court. Whether it is the Supreme Court, whether it is the High Courts, the Commercial Courts, the District Courts, all the courts in the country are grappling with areas of pending cases. I remember as judge, our roster used to be shifted, and sometimes I also had to take up criminal cases, though I didn't exactly have a criminal law background. And so often we had to direct prisoners to be released because they had actually completed the entire period of sentence without their appeal getting heard out. So far as courts are concerned, there are many issues in the courts involving civil rights, constitutional rights, human rights, the right to life, the right to freedom, the right to livelihood. There are disputes with employers, so on and so forth. Now, when we talk about financial dispute, there are different kinds of financial disputes. Disputes relating to financing agreements and loan agreements, where banks and financial institutions advance loans, after which disputes arise. Then, of course, you have infrastructure agreements where there are disputes with regard to the amount which is claimed in terms of the agreement. You have disputes with regard to the consideration for goods sold and delivered and for services rendered, which involve a lot of money. And then, of course, you also have disputes between employees and employers, which are also, in a sense, financial disputes when such employees claim money, which is vital for their, absolutely vital for their survival. Traditionally, all these disputes were decided by courts. But today, we have realized the need to look at alternative dispute redressal fora, which would include mediation, conciliation, and of course, arbitration. So far as this country is concerned, mediation is probably as old as civilization. We hear of mediation in Vedic times, when the panchas, the panchayats, used to mediate disputes. You hear of conciliation from the time of the Mahabharata, the difference between mediation and conciliation is very, very subtle. In the case of mediation, you have an independent, impartial mediator who tries to bring out an agreement, who tries to settle the disputes by agreement between the parties. Conciliation is a little different, where a settlement is actually effected, and our Arbitration and Conciliation Act of 1996 even recognizes conciliation. But perhaps the most important mode of resolution of disputes today, and particularly financial disputes, is arbitration. Now, why is arbitration increasing in popularity? First of all, because the courts are too busy, if I may use the expression. The second thing is that in arbitration, there is an element of mutuality. There is agreement between the parties. The parties agree to the mode of settlement of disputes by arbitration. The parties also agree to the mode and manner in which the arbitral tribunal is going to be appointed, whether the arbitral tribunal is going to comprise of a single arbitrator or of two arbitrators chosen by the parties and a presiding arbitrator, so on and so forth. Of course, we have to admit that though there is mutuality in arbitration agreements, but there are many agreements which are standard form agreements in which the terms and conditions, as also the term for arbitration of disputes, is actually imposed on one party by another. But be that as it may, with the law as it stands today, there are immense advantages of arbitration. One is, you don't go by the formalities of court proceedings. The arbitrator has to be an independent arbitrator. The arbitral tribunal has to be independent. The arbitral tribunal must be neutral, and the arbitral tribunal is bound to treat the parties to the dispute equally and comply with the principles of natural justice. These are the basic rules. Arbitration is expected. Please mind and note the expression which I am using. Arbitrations are expected to be an expeditious mode of resolution of disputes, and it is also meant to be a less expensive mode of a resolution of disputes. Perhaps I might share some of my experiences with you to explain what are the problems which litigants face, arbitrators face, the lawyers who appear in these arbitration proceedings face. What is most important is we should have the will to promote settlement of disputes by arbitration. And we should all have a professional outlook. Very recently, an arbitration bar was established. This is because you have a set of lawyers who primarily practice arbitration. When I try to fix dates as an arbitrator, the requests are invariably fixed dates after quotas. So till 4:45 or 5, you can't fix the arbitrations. You have to fix the arbitrations after 5. No one wants to do arbitrations beyond 8. So far, so good. During the vacation, when the court is in vacation, the lawyers are holidaying. So there are requests saying we will not be in town. Please do not fix arbitrations at this point of time. I think if we call arbitration an alternative forum of dispute resolution, you have to treat the arbitral tribunal like other tribunals, be it the NCLT or the NCLAT or the Green Tribunal, Electricity Tribunals, so on and so forth. Can you say that I will not appear because I have a matter in the High Court or I have a matter in the Supreme Court? No, you can't. So you have to adjust your diary in this way. The second thing is, there needs to be some uniformity in the procedure which is followed. So far as judges are concerned and courts are concerned, nowadays we have judicial academies. We have a National Judicial Academy in Bhopal, and every state has a judicial academy which is administered by the High Court. There we have sessions where discussions take place on different aspects. To bring some uniformity in the arbitral procedure, it is extremely important that you have symposia and meetings of this kind, where you can sit together, discuss, and exchange your views on the best practices which other participants in the meeting can adopt. Again, I will give you very small examples. Very often I tell the parties who come to arbitrate before me that, look, these are arbitral proceedings, not proceedings in court. The strict rules of evidence and the strict rules of the Civil Procedure Code don't apply. A reply which was given to me by a very senior lawyer very recently in Calcutta was, "Ma'am, you are saying this, but do all the arbitrators follow this practice? There are arbitrators who insist that the matter is proved in the same manner as, I would say, not even civil proceedings where the preponderance of probabilities prevails, but the strict rules of criminal law are applied where an offense has to be proved beyond any reasonable doubt." Now, if arbitration proceedings are conducted in this way, they are bound to be time consuming. We have to transform the financial dispute resolution landscape by encouraging arbitration, making the arbitrations effective, cost effective, expeditious, and just, so that no party feels that they have really been denied justice. Now, what do we understand by digital solutions? To a lay person like me, digitalization would mean computerization. And with old fogies like me, many of us may not be we may not be tech savvy, if I may use the expression. But when you make an effort, it does happen. The COVID period was a big example when we all started taking up matters online from our residents, and we did it. The biggest advantage of digitization, that is the use of computers, is pleadings can be filed digitally. It consumes less space because it's all there in the computer. As a backup maybe, you can have a pen drive or two, which again does not occupy much space. Sometimes I start tearing my hair when piles and piles of files come in, and I keep saying that I don't live in a Lutyens Delhi bungalow any longer. I live in rented accommodation. Where do I keep all these files? Some of the institutions, I tell them, now that the arbitration is over, let me return the files. Ma'am, we don't have place for storing the files. And one day I just smiled and said, you have a huge building, you don't have the place to store the files. Why don't you come over to my flat once and see whether I have the place to store the files or not. So the biggest advantage of digitization is you save the space. The documents which are stored are easily accessible. They are easily accessible. Today, you have sophisticated softwares which help you to find documents very easily. We did not have the liquid software earlier, but today you have the liquid software where the markings which you make, you can go back to the markings very soon, you know, without going through pages and pages one after the other. Apart from the space, the accessibility, the short time it takes to find documents, there are other great advantages of digitization. In our country, we have a lot of people who are marginalized. Marginalized not necessarily economically, but because of some kind of disability, which could be a physical disability. Just before I came here, in the afternoon there was an arbitration going on where a lady who was a director herself and the director's wife was giving evidence. She was so tensed, so nervous, and she seemed to know absolutely nothing about what was happening. So when you have such people participating in the arbitration proceedings, you can give a little more publicity to arbitral procedures, and also so that there is some uniformity in the procedures which follow. It should not be that in Calcutta the senior counsel is coming and literally placing a document like this and saying, "Mr. Witness, have you signed this document? Yes. Where is your signature? My signature is here. Will you encircle the signature?" I said, "What's happening? This is arbitration. Just give him all the documents in a lot and ask one question. Have you signed the documents? It's not necessary to ask so many questions and then, you know, place the documents one by one. There are rules, rules which are framed by the Permanent Court of Arbitration. These more or less serve as a uniform guideline. There are other rules framed by different arbitral institutions. These have to be easily available and accessible. And these rules can be easily accessible through the computer. So you have to have a website, and I'm sure you do have one, where you get all these rules in a glance. And then it is for the arbitrator to adopt the best practice, and for the lawyers also to adopt the best practice. When my particulars were being mentioned, it was mentioned that I had been sent by the then Chief Justice of India for a program on judicial administration at the Civil Services College in Singapore. This was way back in 2012 or 2013, when computers were not used in India in the same way that they are used today. I entered a courtroom. I could not see anyone except the judge in the courtroom. There was a computer in front of the judge. There was a screen. Witness action was going on. A Tamil lady, you must be aware that Tamil is also one of the official languages of Singapore. A Tamil lady was giving evidence. The interpreter was interpreting it from the High Commission. And on one day, the interpreter was unable to attend office because her child was unwell. So she was doing the interpretation from her desk at home. Look at the amount of time you save in the process. Today we have international as well as domestic arbitrations where you may have three arbitrators from three different places, counsel from different places, witness from yet another place. If the proceedings can be taken up digitally, expenditure is saved, time is saved. It is cost effective, so far as the parties are concerned, and for everyone else. Again, going back to my junior days, I remember in 1989-90, there was a matter going on in the Supreme Court, and it was very difficult to resist the temptation of saying no to a first important matter in the Supreme Court. Every evening, there used to be conferences, and then 2 to 3 days in a week, I had to be in Delhi. It was all very nice being a first generation lawyer from a family primarily of government servants. I didn't have much occasion to stay in these 5-star hotels, so it was very exciting coming here and coming to Delhi and staying in the best hotels. But what happened at the end of the day was, I lost many of my other solicitors who had been briefing me, because when their matters were being called on, I was not there. Today, you don't have this problem with digitization. So whether it is in court or whether it is before the arbitrator, you can appear digitally. Problems sometimes arise when there is witness action. But with sophisticated computers, you can watch the demeanor of the witness very well. If the computer is turned to the witness, there is no difficulty at all. Then to see whether the witness is getting tutored or not, you can have the representatives of both sides there. Or you can have someone there. Or when it is an arbitral tribunal comprising of, let us say, 3 arbitrators, you can have the witness action in the presence of 1 arbitrator. All the 3 arbitrators don't necessarily have to be there. There are some disadvantages of digitization, because not everyone has sophisticated computers. Sometimes while the proceedings are going on, there are parties who go offline. But everything said and done, these may be minor glitches, but on the whole, there are immense advantages where everyone, the arbitrators, the lawyers arbitrating, the parties to the arbitration, and all other stakeholders, everyone else interested, is aware of the procedures, is aware of the rules framed by different arbitral institutions, is aware of the rules of the institution which is supervising the arbitral proceedings, so on and so forth. Artificial intelligence, which is being used today, has its own uses. Of course, I don't think you can use artificial intelligence for making a complete award. But you know, the smaller orders, for the procedural orders, you can take recourse to artificial intelligence. Much of the research work which we need can be done digitally. In the good old days when we appeared in courts, all of a sudden a judgment would be cited and you would have to go hunting all over to procure the books. Today, with the press of a button, you have the judgment, you have the precedence on the screen. I personally hope that arbitration takes on in a big way, that the arbitrators who are appointed are also arbitrators who are competent, who have experience of the subject which they are arbitrating, maybe commercial law, experience of commercial courts. There is no bar. The arbitrators can also take the help of amicus curiae. And the most important thing today is that the arbitrator has to give a declaration of his absolute impartiality, that he has no kind, he or she has no kind of interest in the subject matter and is not related to the parties or to counsel in any manner whatsoever. Here also, digitization has a great advantage, because the declaration which is being made is there on the computer. So if anyone wants to question it, a question can be raised. To give a very small example, I was elevated as a judge in February 2002. Now February 2002 to July 2024 is a very long time, and with so many cases it is possible that you may not remember a particular case. So if any party has any objection to your appointment, the particulars are there in the computer. They can key into the computer, see the credentials of the arbitrator, and if he finds that there is a possibility of some conflict of interest, then he or she can draw the attention of the arbitrator to such conflict of interest. So I wish this program a grand success, and I do hope that arbitration will take on in this country in a very big way, including institutional arbitration, which has its own benefits. One has to ensure that all those who are associated with the institutions which conduct arbitration are neutral, independent, above board, and not associated with the parties in any way. Because there may be some institutions who may have their set of clients, if I may use the expression, who may be coming to them all the time to get their disputes settled. There, I think even the arbitrator has a very important role to play to ensure that no injustice is done. Needless to say that the entire proceedings, the basis is the faith and the confidence which the litigating parties and the lawyers have in the tribunal of arbitrators. Thank you very much. I once again apologize for the delay in arriving here.